Hello there, and welcome to the Carnival Cafe, the first restaurant to cater exclusively to Miin men and women. I am your hostess, Madame Melian McCoy, and we only select the choicest of cuts for your chewing desires. Start off with an appetizer of our famous chicken nugget kebabs, or perhaps a deli plate, like a veggie plate, but without that cursed cellulose. Indulge in our delicious entrees, such as our four sausage sampler, a beef patty with garnish, or a bowl of bacon. No one will judge you at the Carnivore Cafe for your eating habits, especially not those dreaded vegetable fucking vegans! And save room for dessert! We have bacon sundaes without the ice cream, chicken pot pie without the crust, as that has gluten, which will cause your body to dissolve! Ground beef cup desserts. So, what are you waiting for? Come over to the Carnivore Cafe today and give in to your primal instincts, you dirty animal!
Hey guys, it's Flower Gothic, and I know what y'all are thinking. What the hell, girl? You've been spending these past few months criticizing celebrities and religions. Why are you talking about some diet now? Well, allow me to explain myself. I have recently been introduced to the vegan's worst nightmare, the carnivore diet. The restrictions are rather self-explanatory. You only eat animal products, such as butter, milk, fish, and that sweet, juicy, tender meat. If you have any sense of reason, you'll recognize the obvious problems of this diet. It's high in saturated fats and cholesterol. It doesn't allow you to get other nutrients from produce. And it's much more environmentally devastating than its exact opposite. Normally, I leave diets alone. I think most of them are bullshit and are only supported by anecdotal evidence, but I had an interaction back in November that left me so baffled, I felt compelled to make this video. There's a cute boy who used to be a kitchen employee at the restaurant I worked at. He was, well, is, since as of this taping I'm still seeing him, funny, cute, sweet, nocturnal animal in the bedroom. He follows the keto diet, a kind of precursor to the carnivore diet, but that's a blip on his record that I overlooked because he is a total tad. But one night, while in a sea of ecstasy, I brought up how my restaurant's corporate chef cannot even eat his creations because he follows a special diet of only beef, salt, and water. I asked, how is that healthy at all? The boy explained that from beef, we could get all of the nutrients we need from the grass the cows eat. He also stated that there was a bit of research supporting this, and that having meat only will cut out those dreaded foodstuffs like sugar and gluten. I thought, are you fucking kidding me? That's not how meat works. That's not how anything works. But I just smiled and nodded, as that's what a refined woman is supposed to do. After sex, we then got dinner and he ordered a beef sandwich, thus cheating on his diet. And if you're watching this, Storytime Boy, I still love you, even though you believe in that carnivore diet. It doesn't take away from how cute, sweet, and funny you are. So today, let's take a look at the carnivore diet, from its origins to its ideals to its problems. But first, my mandatory disclaimers so I don't get sued. First of all, as a vegetarian, I have issues with the meat industry, and this results in a potential conflict of interest. I apologize in advance if my stance on meat sticks out at any point in this video. Number two, does the carnivore diet work for you? Well, I'm glad something works for you, but please don't complain at me in the comments just for me expressing my concerns about this diet. Throughout history, there have been limited numbers of humans who subsisted almost exclusively on meat and fish. The Sakak in Greenland lived off of the marine animals they hunted. The Tonkawa in Texas got most of their nutritional intake from the buffalo. But while doing research for this video, I realized something about these ancient civilizations. Most of them were omnivores. The ones that were only carnivores out of necessity. Think about Greenland, for example. Is Greenland a suitable place for crop cultivation? Of course not. Carnivore diet practitioners like to claim that our ancestors lived only off of meat, and that you can too. But here's my counterpoint. Humans didn't really adapt to eating meat until around 2.5 million years ago. One of the earliest alleged human ancestors, the Sahelanthropus chaldensis, had rather tiny canine teeth, thus rendering it difficult for them to chew meat. As a result, it is alleged that their diets consisted of plants high in fiber and nuts. One of the more recent pre-Homo genera, the Australopithecus, had teeth well equipped for heavy chewing, suggesting that their diet was similar to the modern-day herbivorous gorilla. Humans didn't adapt to eating meat until the Homo genus geared up its engines, but even then, the prevalence of meat eaters depended widely on where you were. The Africa-based Homo habilis, on one hand, subsisted off of meats and tough plants they could chew, while the Neanderthals, on the other hand, it varied depending on where they were. Some places didn't have meat at all. Others had too much. And even when Homo sapiens came around, we were still hunter-gatherers until the end of the Paleolithic age. They ate meat and fish, whatever they could hunt, but they also gathered nuts, berries, roots, and anything that could bring even a smidgen of nutritional value into their sad, sad diets. Basically, anything that the paleo diet practitioners claim that paleo people ate. As a more rounded diet was adopted by our later ancestors, there were still a few small isolated groups that subsisted almost exclusively off of animal products. One of the more significant studies of these communities happened in 1972 in Point Hope, Alaska. A mostly Inuit settlement, Dr. Sheldon Feldman compared Point Hope's average caloric intake to the incidence of heart problems in the average American population. While they got 85% of their calories from fat and protein in animals, their incidence of heart disease was 10 times lower than the average American. Was it because they relied on meat instead of those dreaded carbohydrates? That's what carnivore diet practitioners want you to believe, and they'll probably steal this study for their own purposes. But keep in mind the study was published in 1972. In 1972, the American diet consisted of a shit ton of processed foods, like fried chicken, broccoli and cheese, hamburger helper, and porcupine balls. They were my grandmother's specialty, and today I'm gonna show you how to make them. So you're gonna need some ground beef or turkey. It really doesn't matter which one. I'm going to be doing both for convenience's sake. And you will also need some white rice for that porcupine taste. So you're gonna first set your oven to 350 and then mix all of the rice together with your ground meat. You do not need to boil it first. The meat juices will cook it up for you. So just, you gotta get it really good in there. Gotta mash it up like the tender meat it is. Oh yeah, oh yeah. So once you've got that all good and done, you're going to roll up these into little meatballs. And again, don't worry about the rice. The meat will cook it for you while it's in the oven. This is actually taking longer than I thought it was going to take.
Seasoning is not necessary, as the sweet, juicy, tender meat
will flavor it up for you just around fine. So, once you get that out of the way, put your porcupine balls into the oven for around 15 minutes or whenever you feel like they're done, then pull them out and enjoy. Anyway,
That's how you make porcupine balls, my grandmother's specialty. I hope you enjoy this recipe as much as I do. Heart disease isn't necessarily caused by eating meat in the first place, anyway. Diets high in saturated fat, cholesterol, overconsumption of alcohol and/or tobacco, and inactivity are more so confirmed causes. But let's cut to the 21st century. The most notable advocate for the carnivore diet is Sean Baker, a bodybuilder and MD who has eaten nothing but meat since 2017. He claimed that as a result, his joint pain vanished, he sleeps better, and became quite the performer in bodybuilding and in bed. What a chat. And as a doctor, you may think he has some kind of credibility. Right? Well, no. His home state of New Mexico permanently revoked his license in September of 2017 due to failure to report adverse action taken by a healthcare entity and incompetence to practice as a licensee. It was reinstated in 2019, but under the condition that he would be supervised by a proctor approved by the state. To add fuel to this fire of shame, he believes that anecdotal evidence is more reliable than scientific fact, which is the opposite of what doctors believe normally. But he doesn't care. I'll get to the problems with anecdotal evidence another time. I just don't have the time now, but I will say that the theory supporting this diet boiled down to one logical fallacy. I have eaten nothing but meat in the last X months. I have felt a lot healthier in the last X months. Therefore, the carnivore diet makes me feel a lot healthier. Anyway, another major advocate for the carnivore diet is Mikaela Peterson, daughter of...
Think about it historically, you have to say that we're in good times. I mean...
Oh, fuck! Of fucking course Jordan Peterson is somehow involved with this, but mostly his daughter. According to Mikaela, she was a very sickly child growing up, catching diseases faster than incels could catch the anime titty. She had multiple joint replacements at 17 and was on anxiety and depression medication at 10. And now she's completely cured. How? By a very special diet consisting of meat, certain vegetables, and no fruit. After giving birth to her daughter, though, she threw this out and switched to the lion diet, consisting of only beef, salt, and water. She claims that she doesn't need any supplements and that she's happier than ever. When you take a look at her Instagram, you'll see a shit ton of people who followed her and Sean Baker's example. From eating meat and nothing but meat, these chats have received benefits, including curing of eczema, no longer having hemorrhoids or constipation, being relieved of ADD without any medication, curing of multiple sclerosis. But while looking at these stories, I noticed a sense of correlation, but not causation. These people didn't only follow the carnivore diet, but initiated other lifestyle changes as well. One eats only one big meal a day, another lifts weights four times a week, and yet another fasts for a long period of time between meals. And here's the thing, it is claimed that fasting can result in blood sugar improvement, inflammation reduction, and increased brain function. What about exercise? According to the CDC, adults who partake in regular exercise are generally healthier and less likely to develop illnesses, especially in the colder months. And I can attest to that as someone who works out on her days off and does yoga every morning. This year alone, I've only gotten sick like twice, maybe three times. Last time, I was practically bedridden from fatigue after working four consecutive shifts. Meat, mostly, but other animal products, such as milk and cheese. Some people even drink coffee and or tea as well. The logic behind it, as I've said before, is that you'll get all of your nutrients from the meat and eliminate those dreaded carbs. In a way, it's the more limiting cousin of that keto diet you keep seeing at Whole Foods. Keto this, keto that. I bet 90% of you don't even know what that entails. So let me teach you real quick. Oh, we're not doing this part later? Damn, I forgot to memorize it. Let me get out my notes.
So, keto is short for the ketogenic diet, a fad diet that has grown in popularity for the past few years. It is a low-carb, high-fat diet that emphasizes how your body will enter a state called ketosis. Ketosis is when your body metabolizes fat instead of those dreaded carbs because your system is low on glucose. This fat can be transformed in the liver to ketones that can energize you. Now, to be keto, you need to cut out foods high in dreaded carbs, fibers, and sugars, such as, but not limited to, grains, including the gluten-free kind, most fruit, beans, and processed food. What you'll need to eat is meat, fish high in fat content, and low-carb vegetables. Now, keto has scientific backing for children with epilepsy, as it has shown a limited success in reducing their seizure rates and is only used if very few treatment options work. Though regardless, if it works for you, it works for you. That's all there really is to it. If you live in a woke Western world like me, you have probably seen a shit ton of articles claiming that gluten and carbs are the devil and are terrible for you. Put down that white bread and french fry, Billy! You're gonna get the gluten disease and die! But I have a question. Do you fuckers even know what gluten and carbs are? Do you know how they're actually beneficial to the human body? The chemical structure of carbohydrates consists of oxygen, hydrogen, and carbon. They are a series of simple sugars, such as glucose and fructose, joined together to make substances such as fiber and cellulose. Gluten is a protein that naturally occurs in grains like wheat and rye. It holds food together to keep it from falling apart. People claim carbs make you fat and unhealthy, which is true if you have too much of them. It's all about the balance. Namaste. Carbohydrates provide your body with glucose, an essential source of short-term energy that activates during your fight-or-flight response. There are good carbs and bad carbs as well. Good carbs, like whole grains, vegetables high in fiber, and fruits, give your system essential vitamins. Bad carbs, on the other hand, like white bread and processed foods, can lead to weight gain and increase your risk for diabetes. As for gluten, whether or not it's good for you depends on a large amount of factors. If you have a gluten sensitivity or a gluten allergy, you should obviously stay away from them. But whole grains of gluten, as I've just said, contain essential nutrients such as B vitamins and iron. It should be noted that there's no discernible benefit for non-intolerant people to adopt a gluten-free diet. In fact, there is no correlation between gluten and heart disease. And as a vegetarian, I rely a lot on gluten-based mock meat to survive. Even Storyboy admits that I'd probably die without gluten in my diet. And it's a good source of protein for me, so I don't have to live off of peanut butter forever, which I really don't want to do. Or do I? Do y'all remember the food chain from science class? The sun provides energy to plants, which are then consumed by herbivores / primary consumers, who are consumed by secondary consumers, and so on. Humans are, in general, both primary and secondary consumers. We don't eat other secondary consumers because, one, lions and tigers and bears, oh my, are scary, and two, the 10% rule. Here's how that rule works. Plants get 100% of their energy by themselves as their natural producers. Primary consumers get 10% of their energy, the rest lost as heat, and secondary consumers get 1% of the producer's energy, or 10% of the primary consumers. Thus, we get 10% of the energy from plants if we eat them, and 1% if we eat meat. If we were to eat secondary consumers, we would only get 0.1% of the initial energy. So if you're cutting plants out of your life to adopt this all-meat diet, you're essentially throwing away a major source of energy, which is not good. Carnivores claim that meat provides the body with all the essential nutrients, or that our bodies will make up for the deficiency. But what actual nutrients are in meat? Not from all the grass the cow eats, Story Boy! Aside from the usual proteins, meat is a vital source of B vitamins, niacin, and iron. Some meat even has special vitamins like zinc and beef and biotin and pork. They can get the former in nuts and the latter in whole grains. However, these are only 6 vitamins out of over 25. Sure, vitamin B contributes to nervous system function and blood formation, but vitamin A, found in things that aren't meat,
helps with your immune system, as does vitamin C, also not found in meat. Iron is a mineral humans are often deficient in and helps with energy. But vitamin A, needed for strong bones, is found in only leafy greens. Those lousy greens carnivores like to complain about.
Now, normies may say deficiencies in these vitamins are irrelevant. But I'd argue that your body can't necessarily compensate for the loss. A lack of vitamins can result in bleeding gums, bumps on the skin, and scurvy. Before you complain in the comments, keep in mind I said can. Not everyone knows that they're deficient in vitamins. But people like Mikaela Peterson still encourage everyone to try the lion diet at least once. But, there are a few health issues that prevent me from not recommending it to people. Now, as a vegetarian, you may think I'm trying to discourage y'all from eating meat. That's not true at all. I'm a vegetarian for more so sustainability reasons. My point of bringing this up is, again, correlation doesn't naturally lead to causation. Some researchers claim that vegetarians are all around healthier, but from my experience, that's because vegetarians tend to be more health conscious than omnivores. I've certainly become more health conscious even before I adopted the vegetarian diet. When you really think about it, it's all about the balance. Namaste. It is perfectly possible for you to be an unhealthy vegetarian if you meet your requirements by eating nothing but junk food, like cheese pizza and candy bars. And it's also perfectly possible to be a healthy omnivore by balancing your meat intake with whole grains and produce. The health restaurant I frequent here in Houston has a lot of omnivore options, such as adding organic meat to your grain and veggie bowls and gluten-free lasagna bolognese. I try to wash my produce, cut out bad carbs, and not drink milk. I'm lactose intolerant. I take multivitamins each day to get my daily doses of iron and iodine. And what has changed for me? Nothing. Well, I mean, I've lost 10 pounds, but other than that, nothing has really changed. And from what I've seen from other people who have adopted a similar diet, they also haven't experienced much change aside from weight loss.
Basically, I proved exactly what everyone expected this would prove in the most boring and straightforward way possible. It turns out that soybeans are just a kind of bean that you can eat. And it doesn't make that much of a difference.
Who would have thought that drinking the mammary secretions from a pregnant animal would have more feminizing effects on humans than eating an actual bean, hey? Wild.
Over the past couple of decades, numerous researchers have compared vegetarians to omnivores. Overall, there isn't much on the long-term health benefits of vegetarianism, and one study concluded that they have the same mortality rate. It's just a way you can eat for various reasons. PKU is a metabolic disorder present at birth. People with PKU cannot properly break down the amino acid phenylalanine. This AA is commonly found in refined carbs, soy, nuts, fish, and meat. And if someone with PKU consumes too much phenylalanine, it builds up in the body and can cause learning disabilities and behavioral issues. To survive, they eat foods with low or no phenylalanine content, like produce, low protein carbs, and real sugar. They still get protein, but in the form of special formulas that don't have the amino acid.
I once met this girl, she's as pretty as—
The Lone Star Tick is a parasitic insect found all over the eastern United States. It delivers a painless bite, sucking blood for around a week until it finds its next victim. A human bit by the tick has a chance of developing the alpha-gal allergy. Alpha-gal, for the norms who don't know, is a sugar found in mammals we eat, such as pigs and cows. People with this allergy have traditional allergic reactions, but only after 3 to 6 hours of exposure. The only cure is to avoid eating meat from mammals. Poultry and fish, from what I've seen, are still okay. So those who promote the carnivore diet and says that it cures all your ailments, what do people with PKU and the alpha-gal allergy have to gain from it? Is it beneficial for people with PKU to overdose on phenylalanine? Is it beneficial for people with the alpha-gal allergy to self-induce allergic reactions? Is it? A sizable amount of you are here just to write a 15-page comment complaining to me about what I've said. And that's okay. So be it.
If you want to eat me for the rest of your life, that's fine by me. My point in making this video is to criticize a fad diet, and there's no way around that. But again, if it works for you, it works for you. I've tried a low-carb diet in the past, and as a result, I was really low in energy and constantly hungry. It doesn't work for me, but if it works for you, that's good. All I want to do is bring facts and logic to the table to counteract the anecdotal evidence. And if I've educated you in the slightest today, then my work here is done. And if you excuse me, I must return to my life of debauchery.
Oh, you're still here? I thought you ran away after you saw those lies. I myself feel perfectly fine after eating meat and anything but. But I suppose Miss Flower Girl Pick says otherwise. I guess she has a point. But how can you trust her if she's not even brave enough to show her primal instincts?